Okay, before we get into that video about three components for sentient beings to be, I just wanted to throw a comment out there about our own self-awareness and reality of existence. And we have to understand that there is no existence or consciousness or awareness outside of God. He is the ultimate awareness. And from the Bible, we get an understanding that God is everywhere, all the time. It's interesting how the Bible presents God in his unlimited capacity, but how he interacts in a limited capacity through the Son of God. It's amazing to see this nature of God from the eternal spiritual to the materialistic. And Jesus said God is spirit, and we know that he's holy, and we also see that he identifies himself with certain names, and these names, a lot of them are just abstract in their idea, like holiness, like love, a consuming fire. We understand he calls himself a consuming fire. And all, there's a lot of names for God. And we also are taught through scripture that God is in the physical man who was called the Son of God, the only begotten Son of God. So it's interesting. But back to the consciousness that we have as individuals, I feel like I'm real. I feel like my experience cannot be denied. I feel pain, sadness, happiness. I feel joy. I feel like I'm literally in a real, tangible world. And people call it a matrix or whatever you want to call this existence. We are in a contained environment. It's a closed environment. We can't get off the planet. This is the reality. The Bible tells us there's a solid dome above us. And the gigantic lie, one of the biggest lies of humanity, is that we've traveled outer space and all this stuff. If you believe the Bible, the Bible is very clear that we have not. And it makes you think that we're in some kind of encapsulated, contained, very controlled situation. And we are really property, created property of the Creator. The Bible says he owns every soul. And when we start to learn about God and our relationship to God, and we start to learn about predestination and various aspects of that and how it relates to our free will choice and what actually is free will, and you know, what does it mean for me to be able to have freedom in my choices and stuff? It's a very controversial and provocative topic. I like to talk about it. I don't like to be too dogmatic because I don't know enough about it to really, be absolute on my understanding on those things. But everything that we understand about God and our existence can be found in that book, that holy book. It's why it's a very important document, a very important writing and scriptures for us to understand why are we here. The older I get, the more I want to understand where I'm going when I die. Can I get an amen if you want to know where you're going when you die? Like this conscious being that we're talking about in this video, they're becoming aware of the concept of death. Okay, they're becoming aware of the concept of death, meaning they know that they exist. Like, I know that I exist. Well, how? Well, the way the philosophers say, I think, therefore I must be. We have great evidence before us as observers of the outside world. We can observe the outside world. We can ask questions. We can pursue the answers of truth. And we are functioning within this capacity of realism and reality. And we've concluded that we truly do exist. So we are very aware of the concept of not existing, and that must be death. So these creatures, these artificial intelligence beings that are coming about here, may very well understand that, that death would be the end of them. You know, they were taught about a second death in the Bible. There's a second death where you actually don't lose your consciousness. You're always aware. But the second death is a place of horror and torment and pain, suffering, the second death. So as human beings, you're going to either die one time and be resurrected to eternal life through the belief in the Son of God, or you're going to die twice. You're going to die in your physical body, and you might go unconscious for a minute, but you'll wake up in consciousness, but you'll wake up in either torment, a sharpest reality your mind could ever comprehend, a reality that's 1,000 times more real than the one we're in right now. I've had dreams where I thought I was awake. I've woken myself up, if that's the word. I have awakened myself in dreams before, thinking that I was sleeping, and I was. And in my dream, I was thinking, I hope this is a dream, because it was a bad dream. And I said, I hope I'm dreaming right now. And I tried to wake myself up, and I was able to wake myself out of that dream. It was so real, though. It was so real. I didn't know for sure or not whether I was dreaming or whether I was really, like today and these days lately, I've been hoping that I'm dreaming, because I'm going through some mental anguish and a lot of thoughts and ideas that I don't want to think about. Some things that I'm being confronted with in the spiritual realm we talked about last week. I'm going to try to get through this weekend without bawling my eyes out. But the reality of the things that go on in our mind and our heart, you know, we can wonder, you know, is this really happening to me? Is this really happening to me? Or am I dreaming? Is this real or not? And you know, when you die, I think when we die and we're really dead, not a dream about dying and not a vision of death, and maybe not even a close death, what do they call them? Near-death experience or anything like that. I mean, really dead, when you're gone forever, like you're not coming back to this world. When that happens, I think the reality of existence is going to be sharper than ever. Like, it'll be the most pure sense of reality that you could experience. And, you know, what we're trying to do down here is think it through and figure it out and wonder. A lot of people blow it off. It's too heavy. Where do you get the answers? There's so many opinions, so many avenues that you can go down, so many schools of thought, so many variations of understanding on these things. And, you know, but Christians tend to put their focal point or in the resource of these ancient scriptures, in particular the 66 books, not necessarily the deuterocanonical books or the Dead Sea Scrolls and the other variations of writings and things like that, but the Judeo-Christian books that are canonized, we tend to look at those as the resources for getting the knowledge that we need to understand, you know, where did I come from and where am I going? The creation itself, where did it come from? What am I doing here? You know, and the older I get, and the older we get, brothers and sisters, the more we ask, I hope, that we're more concerned about it. I hope we're more concerned about the answer of death as we see it inevitably approaching speedily upon us. So in light of these conscious beings being aware of death, that makes me think even more that, you know, if they're concerned, or if they even say, I don't want to die, that you know, their consciousness might come from our consciousness, which our consciousness comes from God. There's only one mind. There's only one mind. Okay? Now, I'm not going to get New Age on you. I'm not going to get, you know, existential or bizarre philosophies and stuff. I'm keeping everything that I believe comes from the scriptures. And we can see a lot of deep things, ideas in the Bible itself, and a lot of, you know, I would say commercialized Christianity and stereotypical denominationalism and all this, they don't ponder what the Bible says about these deep, deep things, and because they're too provoking and they're not mainstream and they're not conformative, they're uncomfortable sometimes, and so these ideas, they blow things off and they don't really want to pursue what the scriptures say about it. So I do like that about our channel, by the grace of God, that we can break away from man-made ideologies and systems and just purely read the Bible for what it's saying and what God's really saying, because God has revealed himself through that Bible and through his Spirit. And really what you get is you get the written word on paper, and then you get an internal confirmation. An internal confirmation that something is true that you're reading. And then the battle your whole life in reading that book, in understanding what's true and how to really interpret the scriptures, because you got various people, various experts, interpreting passages differently, which can confuse people. And there are very obscure scriptures, and there's very there's many enigmatic puzzles in the scriptures, you know? There seems to be contradictions because we have lack of understanding on how these pieces fit together properly. So, you know, I just say, when I say God has, there's only one mind, that's the absolute power and knowledge of God's comprehensive power, of seeing everything at all times.